Father, we need you. We need you, Lord. And everything that we do, we need you. We know that we are only alive today because of your mercy, because of your grace, because of your love. We know that we are not without you. And once again, Lord, we come to you, humbling ourselves, asking you to talk to us, asking you to empower us, asking you to edify us, asking you to talk to us, asking you to change us, to mold us, to shape us, so that we become day by day more like you. This is what we desire. And Lord, we know that we are not able to do that without you, without your grace, without your love. And that's why we come to you now, asking in faith, Lord, to help us. To help us be the kind of children that you want us to be. Lord, talk to us in this message. Be with us. Let our ears, our spiritual ears, be attentive to everything that you have to say. Lord, don't let our problems, our concerns, take away what you have to offer for us today. Lord, we ask you and we praise you in advance in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. I want you to use your Bible or make use of your preaching handout. And we are going to be listening from, we are going to be reading from 1 Peter chapter 1. From verses 13 to 17. 1 Peter chapter 1, from verses 13 to 17. It reads like this: Therefore, prepare your minds for action, and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. And if you call on him as Father, who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile. Amen. The title of this message is Be Holy, for I Am Holy. Be holy, for I am holy. The history of humankind starts with God creating the world and creating humankind. The Bible says that God puts humankind, at that time represented by the first couple, Adam and Eve, in a garden. And there, the couple, the humankind, it starts a relationship with God. So first of all, we need to understand that God is self-sufficient. God doesn't need anybody. God doesn't need any relationship with any person. But the Bible says that God decided to create humankind so that he's able to enter into a relationship with humankind. Adam didn't do anything to deserve to be in the garden. Eve didn't do anything to deserve to be in the garden. But God put them in the garden. And in the garden, they had everything. They didn't have any diseases. They didn't have any problems. They didn't have death. They didn't have anything that was evil. And the Bible says that God put some stipulations, basically saying, this is what you can do. This is not, this you cannot do. And unfortunately, the first couple, they disobeyed God. And by disobeying God, what they were doing is that they were damaging the relationship that they had. The Bible says that as soon as the first couple sinned, they looked at themselves and they realized that they were naked and they didn't want to approach God as they used to. So what the Bible is saying is that before the first sin, Adam and Eve, they had a very intimate relationship with God. They talked with God. They walked with God. They enjoyed God's presence. Everything was fine. The relationship was awesome. But as soon as they sinned, the relationship changed. The relationship was not the same. Not only in the sense that they lost the garden, they were expelled from the garden. They also now started suffering. They had to work. But worst of all, they lost the intimacy that they once enjoyed before they sinned. So the first fall, the first sin of humankind, also talks about how we lose contact, we lose intimacy, relationship with God. That sin also brought physical and spiritual death. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verse 14, strive for peace and for holiness, without which no one will see God. Strive for peace and holiness. So here it's saying that without holiness, we cannot see God. When Adam and Eve, they sinned, they disobeyed God, what basically they were doing is that they were breaking the covenant of holiness. They were not being holy as God wanted them to be. Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, writing in his book, chapter 59, verse 2, says the following: but your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. So basically what we have here, your iniquities, your wrongdoings, they have made a separation between you and your God. Can you see? So here we see exactly what happened in the garden. The iniquities of Adam and Eve separated them from God. And your sins, the sins of Adam and Eve, have hidden his face from you so he does not hear you. The same applies to me and you. God is expecting holiness from all of us. And when we are not holy, what we are doing is that we are the ones that are moving away from God. We are the ones that are separating ourselves from God. We are the ones that are alienating ourselves from God. Why? Because the Bible says that God is holy, completely holy. And when we sin, he cannot be with us. Apostle Paul, writing to the Romans, in chapter 8, verse 7, he says, for the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And now he's talking about the mentality, the mindset, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, is enemy to God. When we do not have the Holy Spirit living in us, we cannot be friends with God. This passage, by the way, it was a passage that God gave through Moses. He said to the people, be holy because I am holy. And now he's using Apostle Peter to echo that same commandment, that same requirement, telling to us today, be holy for I am holy. Since God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he never changes, if he was holy in the past, he keeps being holy now. If he required holiness in the past, he keeps requiring holiness right now. And how are we going to be holy? According to Peter. Peter gave basically 6 points in which we need to be holy. The first one is, prepare your minds for action. Prepare your minds for action. The battle always starts in the mind, and the battle is always lost in the mind. Since our body, our actions, and our behavior, everything is driven by our minds, by what we think. Not what we say, what we really think. Unfortunately, many Christians, sometimes, we do not have the right understanding about God and what he requires of us. So, sometimes, some Christians, they came to me, for example, telling me, Wellington, but the Bible says, I've been hearing since I was a kid that God is so loving, that God sent his son to die for me, and that Jesus died in my place. So, if God is so loving, why do I have to keep doing some things? It seems like these are fanatics. They're saying that we should be doing this and that. The Bible also says that Jesus, when he was at the cross, he said, it is finished. The Tetelestai in the Greek, it is finished. So if it's finished, I don't have to do anything else. God did everything to me. But they lose something very important here. In the same way that the first couple didn't have to do anything to deserve the garden, God created and stipulated some conditions so that they could stay in the garden. They didn't have to do anything to enter into the garden. The Bible doesn't say that Adam said, God, I want to be in your garden. Can you put me in your garden, please? It's a nice, awesome garden. Can I go there? Can I enjoy whatever you have in there? No, God is the one who created that awesome garden and put them there. Just like God is the one who put us in his family. He is the one that adopted us so that we became his children. But at the same time, he said, now that you are my children, I have some requirements. This is the way that my house works. If you want to be my children under my roof, these are my rules. I'm loving. Yes, I'm loving, but I'm also just. And this is what I expect of you. I expect you to be holy. Why? Because I am holy. And sometimes we have a wrong understanding. People read, for example, you can use your handout to read these verses with me. In Romans 5, verse 20, Apostle Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, he wrote the following. But where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. Basically saying is, no matter how much you sinned, no matter how much evil things you did, the grace of God is always going to be more, more. If your sins are like this, the grace of God is bigger, is higher, is better. And because of that, a lot of people say, okay, this is interesting. It's saying that no matter how much I sin, God's grace is bigger, better, so I can do pretty much what I want. Because no matter what I do, God's grace is always going to be better, higher, superior. And Apostle Paul saw that people were thinking like this and said, no. You guys are getting it wrong. So he kept on writing to answer these questions that sometimes we have. And in Romans chapter 6 now, he wrote the following. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin so that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Are we to continue? Are we to sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed, and having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. Amen. Paraphrasing, Apostle Paul was saying, okay, since God is so loving, God is so amazing, should we keep on sinning? By no means, no way. But we are not under law, we are under grace. Should we keep on sinning? By no means, no. The fact that Christ died for you and for me, it does not give us the right to keep on sinning. This is important. And I'm going to use an illustration here. How many married people in the house? I'm going to start talking to the men and see how the wives or the women are going to react to this illustration. What if a man who is married to a woman and he says, my wife, she really loves me. She loves me so bad. There are no words to describe how she loves me. Even when I try to describe it, I can't find the words. There are no words to describe it. Because she loves me so dearly, so much. The more I try to convey it in words, but I can't. So, because my wife, she loves me so much, I am always trying to create opportunities for her to love me even more. So, for example, after taking a shower, I take the wet towel and I leave it sometimes over the couch. Sometimes I leave the towel over the bed or even on the floor, because it will give the opportunity for my wife to get it and put it in the washroom again. And she will have the chance and opportunity to forgive me more, to love me more. Or every time that I go and I use the washroom, I don't flush. Because I want to give another opportunity for my wife to love me even more. She really loves me. And I'm always creating opportunity for her to love me more, more, and more. Women in the house, would you like to have a husband like that?
Never.
Why not? Your husband is giving you the opportunity for you to show your love, your appreciation for him. And after we listen to an illustration like this, probably most of you are saying, this is ridiculous. Yes, it is ridiculous. But why do sometimes we think that we can use the same logic with God? The more I sin, the more I do things, the more he will love me. If it doesn't work between a husband and a wife, or a wife and a husband, how can we say that it works with God? No matter what I do, God is always going to be with his arms wide open to receive me. Apostle Paul is saying, by no means God expects you to be holy. Just like the woman, the wife is expecting the husband to put the towel where it's supposed to be. So he says, prepare your minds for actions. Don't create excuses in your understanding, your mind, that you can do whatever you want, that God, he's so perfect, so loving, that he doesn't care. He does care. God expects me and you to be holy. The second point is, be sober-minded. Sobriety in the Bible here basically means self-control. The Bible presents having self-control as one part of the gift of the Holy Spirit. You have self-control. The Bible and God expect us to have self-control. You can drink whatever you want to drink, as long as you don't get drunk. You can eat whatever you want to eat, as long as you don't eat too much. You can speak whatever you want to speak, as long as you don't speak too much or you speak the wrong things. It's not about what you do, it's how you do, when you do. We are called to have self-control. Self-control. We are not able to control circumstances. We're not able. We don't know when we're going to die or how we're going to die. We don't know when gasoline is going to go up. We don't know. But the way we react to all the circumstances show if we are striving to be holy, if we are fighting to be holy or not, in our self-control. Sometimes people come to us and they say something that we don't like. And usually what happens, if you're a human, you think of something and say, I'm going to tell her. Today is the day I'm going to tell her. I'm going to tell him what he needs to hear. But then, the Holy Spirit comes to you and says, don't do that. Don't say that way. Don't speak that way. And your flesh is, but I want to say it. I really want to say it. Say, hey, be sober-minded is have self-control. But he was not supposed to talk to me like that. The fact that he didn't have self-control doesn't give you the right also to lose your control. How we react is important. This is being holy. No matter how people react towards you, they act towards you. How you react to them is what's really important. We don't have control over people's actions. We have only control about our own actions. This is to be sober-minded. Sometimes, for example, a husband comes to a wife and says the following, please forgive me. I said something that I should not have said. I did something that I should have not done. And basically, when we are asking for forgiveness, and it happens, what we are doing is, I am acknowledging that I lost my control. I was not supposed to tell you what I told you. So at that time, I lost control. I did not have the control over my actions. I did not have control over my words. I did not have control over my feelings. And every time that we don't have control, do you know what happens? We sin. And we make mistakes. So he's saying, strive for holiness. Be sober-minded. God gave you a spirit to control your life. Act accordingly. This is holiness. Set your hope, number three, set your hope fully on the grace of God. Fully set your hope on grace. I remember watching recently a documentary in which a man, he murdered another young man. And now they were talking how the mother and the father of the deceased man, they go and they have a relationship with the killer. They go to the prison, they talk to them, they preach the gospel to them. That man says that he is now a believer, and they sing songs together, and they go to the prison to meet that man regularly. The man who killed their son. What if that parent was you or me? And you probably must be thinking, as I was thinking when I was watching the documentary, I was looking at my sons and thinking, would I be able to do that? And at the time I was saying, probably not. But the issue is, we are only able to do such things if we set our hope fully on the grace of God, knowing that this power does not come from us, but it comes from God. God is the one empowering to do that. And what I do like about the word hope here is that hope in the Hebrew thinking is not the same way that we understand hope. Hope for most people in the Western world means wishful thinking. I hope, or I wish I went to college. I hope that I'm going to go to college someday. But they don't really know if they're going to go or not. I hope that I buy a house. But I don't know. I'm not going to have the money to buy it. I hope that I fix my marriage, but probably I'm not going to be able to do that. Hope in the Bible is not like that. Hope is something that you know that it's going to happen. Like the hope that I'm going to become like Jesus is I know that I'm becoming day by day like Jesus. Hope that I'm going to meet him. I know that I'm going to meet him. Hope is not something that, there is a chance that it might not happen. This is not how hope is described in the Bible. This is the way that we understand hope, but it's not the way that the Hebrew writers wrote. When they say hope is something that they know and they are expecting to happen. So why sometimes we have a hard time forgiving people? Because we hope, but we do not expect it to really happen. So we need to set our hope fully on the grace of God. Number four, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance. If you guys were reporters, journalists, and you decided to interview people on the streets, and you asked them about their dreams, their aspirations, their goals, what would you think that people would answer you? If you just choose somebody randomly on the street to say, what's your goal? What do you want? Do you think that most people, they would answer the questions just like the model, saying, oh, I want world peace? Or that people would say, I want, you know, hunger in the world to end. Most people, they answer, I want to be wealthy. I want to be rich. I want to have thousands and thousands of followers on social media. I want to make money. I want to be famous. I want to be able to travel the world. I want to be able to do everything that I want without having to work. And he's saying, if you are looking to be holy, your passions, your desires, your aspirations cannot be the aspirations that you had before you met Christ. When you are not a believer, maybe you had these dreams. Now that you are a believer, your dreams need to be different. Your dreams, your aspirations, they need to be aligned with God's dreams and aspirations. It needs to have a change. You cannot have one dream without God and keep the same dream with God, because it doesn't happen like this. We can see this in the life of Apostle Paul, for example. Apostle Paul, he used to be a serial killer. He used to enter into people's house, to break into people's houses and arrest people and kill people and give the right to kill people, just like he did with Stephen. After he had an encounter with God, his life changed. His goals were not the same. Now he wanted to save people. Now he used to go from place to place to kill. Now he was going from place to place to preach, to teach, to heal, to build churches. He used to put people in prison. Now he was the one being sent to prison. He used to kill people, and now he was able to willingly give his life for this cause. You see, now that he was striving for holiness, his behavior changed. Fifth point, be holy, for I am holy. Please do not mistake being holy with having to dress a certain way or having to use the hair in such and such a way. This is not how the Bible presents holiness. Holiness in the Bible is presented, for example, as a separation, as being set apart for something. Holiness means being used for only one purpose. That's why sometimes people, they make mistakes, because they see the Bible says that being holy is to be separate. And then people say, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to buy a property in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of the jungle, or in the middle of the desert. And I'm going to be there because I'm going to be separate. I don't have people to talk to me. And then I'm going to be holy there. That's not what separation in the Bible means. The Bible says that Jesus, when he was praying, and this prayer was recorded in John chapter 17, the Bible says that Jesus says, Father, I don't pray that you take them away from the world. I want you to keep them one in the world. Because the Bible says that we are supposed to be the light. We are supposed to be changing the world for better. How are we going to change the world if we do not talk to people? If we do not see people? If we do not visit people? How are we supposed to influence people for the better if we don't have a relationship with such people? That's not the separation that the Bible is talking about. Jesus was holy. Jesus was separate. Jesus was set apart. But he was eating with prostitutes. But he was eating with robbers, thieves. He had a relationship with sinners. And by the way, Jesus started a relationship with you. And what were you? And me? sinners. But he was separate. He was not sinning with us. That means separate. I'm used for one thing and one thing only. I'm going to use a few more examples. In the Old Testament, when the Bible talks about the temple, the Bible said, if you are going to use a vessel, something, an object, for the temple of God, when you consecrate that object only can be used for God. So if there is a jar, and you say that this jar is for God, it means that the jar can only be used for God, for nothing else. Basically, when the Bible says that we are holy, the Bible says, you can only be used by God and no one else. If you belong to God, God is the only one that can use you. So, if your mouth is used to praise God, to talk to God, to edify the church, your mouth cannot be used to lie. Your mouth cannot be used to slander, to curse. Because being holy means that you are only used for that purpose. Only. So being holy is whatever we do, we can only be used by God for nothing else. Nothing else. This is means holy. Holiness. My entire body, everything that I do, if I do for God, I cannot do for God on Sunday and Wednesday. And the other day say, you know what? Yeah, no. Either you belong to God or you don't. This is holiness. This is holiness. Only be used by God. If we are only used by God, there is no room for revenge. There is no room for lack of forgiveness. There is no room for evil. There is no room because we are only used by God. And the Bible says that God is only able to use us if we are holy. Genesis 17:1. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty, walk before me faithfully and be blameless, or in other words, be holy. In Leviticus 19, which was the first time that God mentioned to be holy in the Old Testament, basically Apostle Peter is quoting this passage here. I put a summary of what the Bible asks in Leviticus 19. Be holy, for I am holy. Respect your mother and father. This is being holy. Don't steal. Don't lie. Don't deceive one another. Do not defraud or rob your neighbor. Don't show partiality to the poor or favoritism to the great. Don't go about spreading slandering among your people. Don't seek revenge. Don't hold a grudge. Show respect for the elderly. Do not mistreat the foreigner. Basically saying, this is what I expect of you. If you are used only by God, that's all you can do. Apostle Paul was saying that we become slaves. It's like we become slaves of God. We don't do... Do you think that slaves, they have a choice? Do slaves have a choice? I'm not going to do today something today, you know? I don't feel like working today. Sorry, we're going to work today. Basically saying, if we are slaves to God, is I don't feel... Oh, you were called to do that, and you're going to do that. But not only because we are going to do something against our will. Our will wants to be like that. Because we were born. We died to our old self, and this is what we desire now. We desire these things. Everything, everywhere where God is, it becomes holy. In Exodus 3:5, do not come any closer. God is talking to Moses. God said, take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. I was here yesterday, it was not holy. Why is it holy now? Because God is there. The same thing happened with Joshua. The commander of the Lord's army replied, take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy. And Joshua did so. What changed? God's presence. So basically saying, if God lives in me and you, we are holy and we need to be holy. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 4. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. Wow. The Bible is saying that God chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless. And I want to quote one German pastor and theologian called Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who, by the way, was murdered by the Nazis. He coined one term called cheap grace. Cheap grace. What is cheap grace? Cheap grace is the grace we bestow on ourselves. Cheap grace is preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance. Baptism without church discipline. Communion without confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship. Grace without a cross. Grace without Jesus Christ, living and incarnate. So he says, what is cheap grace? Grace is that grace that we believe that we only have to receive and we don't have to do anything. So we talk about forgiveness, but there are no repentance. We don't have to change. Baptism without church discipline. How many parents are there in the house? Have you ever been able to raise your kids without having to correct them? Oh, my children, they are so loving and obedient. I never have to say anything. They don't need to be corrected. Never. Awesome. Do you know somebody like this? But now we are in the position of children. The Bible says that we are the children of God. But when God wants to correct us, say, I don't want to be corrected. I don't need correction. Why do I need correction? Do you think that our kids, your kids, can live without correction? No. The same way we cannot live without being corrected by God. We need to be corrected by God. In fact, the Bible says that the only way that we are going to prove that we are his children is if we accept his correction. The only way. Communion without confession. We come here and we take part of the body and the blood of Christ, sometimes without thinking about what we did in the week or month, or if we have a problem with somebody, it's like, God is so good that he's going to forgive me. I don't have to do anything. I don't have to talk to the person. No! This is cheap grace. Jesus was the one who said, if you are going to present something for me and you have a problem with somebody, go there and make peace with the person first and then come to me and present whatever you have to present to me. Because I require holiness. You need to be holy as I am holy. And lastly, he said, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile. Conduct yourself with fear throughout the times of your exile. Fear here is not like you are afraid of God. It's knowing how majestic God is, how marvelous God is, how powerful God is, how awesome God is, how holy God is. Taking to mind in everything that you do, when you work and when you study, whatever you're doing, fearing God, taking God into account in everything that you do. The Bible says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. When you fear the Lord, is you are becoming wise. When you don't fear the Lord, is when we are exactly foolish. And finally, to conclude, I would like to use this illustration to finish. We have this expression in English: the apple does not fall far from the tree. Meaning, basically, what's the meaning of this expression? Children are supposed to be like their parents. We know that it doesn't happen all the time, but I'm talking about character. If your father taught you how to respect other people, you are supposed to respect other people. If your father taught you to be a hard-working person, you're supposed to be a hard-working person. And what's the message here? God is holy as our Father, and He expects us to be holy just like He is. He expects us to be holy. Jesus also used another analogy. Jesus said, we are branches. We are like branches in one tree. Is it possible for a branch of an apple tree to start producing mango? Is it possible for a branch of a pear tree to start producing watermelon? No. So basically he's saying, if we are the branches and the trunk of the tree and the root of the tree, they are God. Whatever God is producing is the same thing as we are producing. If God is always producing holiness, we are also to produce holiness. Pay attention. I'm not saying that we are going to be perfect. Nobody's perfect. Apostle John said, little children, do not sin, but if you sin, you have an attorney, you have an advocate, you have somebody to fight for you. But sin is supposed to be an exception. Sin is not supposed to be the norm. We are called to be holy. And when we are holy, and when we are seeking this in this process of sanctification, you know what happens? That fear that Adam and Eve had because they were sinning. I don't want to talk to God because God is holy. I don't want to be in the presence of God because God is holy. When you're striving for holiness and you're doing this, you're not afraid. God, I'm striving to be holy just like you are holy. I want to be closer to you. And when we are closer to Him, He's able to use us and use us mightily. That's why it's extremely important for us to do our best, empowered by the grace of God, to be holy. God called us for holiness. Amen. Holy, holy. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we had to be in your house today. Lord, we ask you to forgive our sins. We ask you to keep cleansing us, purifying us in everything that we do. And we know that we are not able to do that without your power, without your grace, without you being the one helping us to achieve everything that we do. But Lord, we do believe that in you we are more than conquerors. And we are going to increase in holiness, Lord. We are striving for peace and holiness and sanctification, Lord, because you are holy. Lord, bless every single person that is here. Give them an amazing week, a blessed week. Father, guide their steps, guide their thinking, guide their thoughts, everything that they are, Lord. Be with them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen.